Welcome everyone to Live at 5. I'm Pattie Braga and I head up Ventura County Leadership Academy, VCLA. And today on Live at 5, we'll talk to some amazing leaders in our region who are also veterans. They continue to serve and advance their careers in the private sector following their service to our country. During today's show, please be sure to put your comments and all your questions in the chat. We'll get to those later in the program. Also, I'd like to thank our sponsor for being here, especially our presenting sponsor, California Lutheran University School of Management. Now let's meet our panel. Becky, let's start with you.
Hi, Patty. I'm so honored to be with you and this group of veterans here this afternoon. I'm a former Naval Intelligence Officer myself. I'm now a strategic communications consultant to government agencies, and I was elected in 2018 to the Pleasant Valley School District Board of Trustees. My husband is also retired from the Navy, now flies for the airlines, and we have two boys. We decided to settle in Camarillo after retirement, and we're just excited to be part of the Ventura County community. And we are involved in so many things in the community. It's a great place to have families. It's a great place to launch a post-military career.
Becky, it's so great to have you. Now let's learn about Daniel.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. It's an honor to be included among such distinguished professionals on this panel. I'm Daniel Bendar. I'm the Chief Strategy Officer at CBC Federal Credit Union. I grew up here in Ventura County in Camarillo, went to high school at Rio Mesa, was recruited by the Naval Academy to play college football. I graduated from the Naval Academy in 2008, was commissioned as a surface warfare officer. A few years later, I made the transition into the intelligence community. I spent 10 years on active duty. I'm extremely grateful and fortunate to have been able to take advantage of the great military education benefits. I have my master's in national security and strategic studies from the War College. I was able to use my GI Bill to get my MBA from UNC, and then I'm continuing to use my GI Bill to complete a two-year executive program at Wharton. In addition to the duties at CBC, I'm the chair of the board for Studio Channel Islands, and I teach as an adjunct professor at CLU. I have two boys, 9 and 7, so overall, I feel like I keep pretty busy, and again, it's an honor and privilege to be here today.
Wow, that's an amazing history, and a local, too. So great to know. Next, we'll introduce Don Plummer. Don?
Thanks, Patty. Very glad to be here with this esteemed group of panelists. I'm currently the Chief of Staff for Arcutis Biotherapeutics and also head of their ESG. Some years ago, kind of made the transition from the military over to the civilian sector, leaving active duty back in close to 2000, just as things were fairly quiet and then the world changed. I've been very fortunate to have a great civilian career as well as a Navy career as well. And kind of similar to other people in to the panel here, made the transition to Thousand Oaks and to Ventura County and find it a great place to raise my kids, both 14 and 11, and call this home.
Sounds great, Don. Thanks so much for sharing. Next, Eric.
Thank you, Patty. It really is an honor to be a part of such an incredible group of veterans. I'm obviously a veteran as well. I actually grew up in Ventura County and went to Camarillo High School. After high school, I ended up enlisting in the Marine Corps, and I wanted to serve my country in that way, and was an infantry Marine, did two tours of Afghanistan, Helmand Province. And then after my military service, I ended up moving back home, and now I reside in Ventura County. I also used my GI Bill, went to Cal Lutheran for undergrad and earned my MBA at Pepperdine. And now I'm a financial advisor at Edward Jones and live in Camarillo with my family, have two young boys and a daughter on the way.
Eric, we're so glad to have you back.
Thank you.
And then our final panelist is Brick Connors. Brick, as you might know, was a Top Gun pilot. I think we have a video coming up.
Thank you. Wow, what a great group. And thanks, Pattie, for the introduction. It's good to see you again in a box. This career of 27 years brought me to Ventura County for my last job as a base commander here at Naval Base Ventura County. And through that, I've developed some unbelievable relationships with folks in this group tonight, but also professional folks that helped me transition from one career to several others in the span of the last 10, 12 years. We got a family here that didn't want to move away from Ventura County after I retired. And I'm glad that they made that decision for me, because this is a great place to live and a great place for senior folks in the military to transition to. So thanks for having me on today.
Brick, it's so great to have you here. And it was so nice meeting you all. As I mentioned earlier, I'm your host, Pattie Braga. I joined Ventura County Leadership Academy after over 20 years in the financial sector. And I have the honor of serving as VCLA's executive director. Being a part of VCLA gives me the opportunity to spend time and learn from our participants each year. VCLA participants are leaders in their field and represent the educational, not-for-profit, business, and public sectors from all across our county. It is truly an honor for me to be the ED of VCLA and to work with the board and alumni to live our mission of connecting people and issues to strengthen our county. And I am honored to be with all of you. Now, with that, thank you all again for joining us and engaging with these leaders on this panel. I'm excited to hear from them. So let's dive in. Now, I want this to be a roundtable discussion and engage our panelists of experts in, and you, our audience. So please don't forget to put your questions in the chat. Becky, I'm going to start with you. Why did you get into the military service? Was it a family thing?
I saw Top Gun. I mean, it's easy. Just kidding. Yes, my dad was also a naval intelligence officer. So I was exposed to it at an early age. I grew up with a lot of Navy kids, and I was attracted to being part of that military community and being around military families. And it was just very inspiring to me. And like most officers, I had some familial connection. I would say most female Navy officers are known for being Navy juniors, having a parent in the service.
Well, that makes perfect sense. Daniel, can I ask you, what advice to successfully transition out of the military into the civilian world?
Yeah, no, thank you. One of the best pieces of advice I received right when I was transitioning out was to let your military experience speak through your actions and not through your words. You know, our military service is unique. It's a very big part of our lives, and in many cases, it becomes our identities. And we should be proud of it. And it won't come out naturally, directly. But on a day-to-day basis, it's best practice to leave it out directly, meaning when you're debating, planning, organizing, certain things, you don't have to tie it to an experience you had in the military. Rather, attempt to turn that story into applicable civilian terminology. So that also means doing a little work on understanding general business concepts. You know, some people understand the military, some people do not at all. Some people are intimidated by it. In my opinion, your best course of action is to let those lessons you learn speak for themselves, because they absolutely will. And I've had faith in that. And then another piece of advice I received was, you know, allow that also ties to allowing your experience to speak for itself, is to listen more than you talk. You know, I think that can be hard when you've been in some of the intense leadership positions that we have experienced and you just want to teach. But I found that the most effective way to get things done in the civilian world is to ask strategic questions and allow those answers to get you where you want.
Wow, great answer.
Thanks.
Don, we'll go to you next. What aspects of your military training have you found to be the most beneficial in the civilian workplace?
Thanks for the question, Pattie. So when I think about it, the military is great for giving diversity of roles and responsibilities. And being thrust into new situations, new learnings all the time, really give you the opportunity to kind of hone your different skills. So as I think about it, diligence, really being able to kind of follow through on the different tasks, attention to detail, always important, and teamwork. The military is really focused on teamwork. You don't do anything alone. And I don't think that you really do in the civilian sector either. So being able to rely on your teamwork and your colleagues really sets you up for success and understanding that.
Thanks, Don. Eric, many veterans find it difficult to transition from the military to civilian life, especially in the workforce. What would you consider some key factors for your ability to be able to transition?
Thank you for the question, Patty. You know, I really want to highlight a point that you made. Many veterans do struggle with the transition, especially coming from an enlisted experience. I personally know a lot of veterans who are still struggling, and it's been many years since leaving the Marines, and they struggle with PTSD, and they struggle with family dynamics that make it difficult. And they get out of the military, and they don't really know what they want to do with their career, what they want to do with their life. They move back home to the same environment where they were when they left high school, and it really makes it difficult for them to transition. So one of the key factors that I see as most important is don't be afraid to seek help, whether it's with your psychological issues and things that you dealt with in the military, or seek help professionally. Find a mentor and be willing to be humble and start new as an intern and start from the bottom. Be willing to do that grunt work. And those were the real factors I felt like it at least allows you to have a good restart in your transition. And then you could kind of put the pieces together as your career progresses and use what you learn from the military to carry you through your career.
Wow, that's some great advice. I've learned two things already: ask for help and listen more than talk. So thanks, guys. Rick, we'll go to you next. What is the most significant disadvantage senior military officers face in the transition?
Well, in one word, it's time. After 27 years, you are not part of a younger professional group that has allowed to mature, navigate a variety of different professional milestones in a particular career. And you're starting from scratch, basically, without a whole lot of time to make those connections, develop those relationships, and invest in other skill sets that you may or may not have that are needed. And so you really rely on a network of others that have gone before you, the same predicament, I guess, and also develop relationships outside of your normal career progression when you're in the military. I had the benefit of being a naval base, and I was out in the public, got to meet a lot of folks that really helped me out. But a lot of folks in my situation do not have natural access to those relationships.
Thank you so much, Greg. You're absolutely right. I think time is a stress for all of us. And thank you all for this great discussion. Let's take a really quick break and hear from some of our sponsors.
There are over 4,000 students at California Lutheran University,
each with our own unique backgrounds, upbringings, and beliefs.
We don't look the same
or think the same,
but we do share one thing in common. We're open to learning about the world,
open to exploring new ideas,
and open to discovering our purpose.
Because when you're open,
the world is open to you.
Good afternoon. My name is Gerhard Apfelthaler. I'm the Dean of the School of Management at California Lutheran University, your proud host of the Live at 5 show this afternoon. As many of you know, we offer programs at the graduate and undergraduate level, but what some of you may not know is that Cal Lutheran is actually ranked number 8 among master's granting universities in the entire Western United States, and that we also offer services to the community, such as our Center for Economic Research and Forecasting's economic forecasts, and of course, Hub 101, the startup community space in Westlake Village, which is operated by our Steve Dorfman Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship. Check us out at www.clu.edu and enjoy the show.
Everyone, welcome back. Let's continue our discussion with this esteemed panel. Becky, I'm going to go back to you. What challenges have you faced in the military and in business as a woman, and how have you met those challenges?
I would say the main challenge is work and family life balance, whether you're in the military or you are in the civilian sector. That is the hardest thing to balance. For myself, I was also married to an active duty serviceman, so we had to balance two careers and a family. And the reserves did give me the opportunity to continue in my military career after having children. And it's just families have to make hard decisions sometimes about who's going to go where and take what opportunities. But I would say that it's very similar in those respects, and finding that balance is difficult for mothers and fathers. Especially being taken away from your kids for something like a deployment. So I know everyone here knows what that sacrifice is about. And I think that's the hardest thing for all parents to do.
I would say that military service certainly sounds like a family effort.
Yeah. Certainly is.
Daniel, now you're the Chief Strategy Officer at CBC Federal Credit Union. Strategy also includes culture. So what things have you done to improve the culture at CBC?
Yeah, no, thank you for the question. Strategy is not just about program and product development. It's also about developing the culture of the team. And that starts with building team cohesion of the senior management team, your executive team. One of the things I've done recently that's been really an interesting a journey is we've had our executive team read the five dysfunctions of the team. I've had them go through workbook exercise together. So the five dysfunctions of the team is a book by Patrick Linciani. And so the five dysfunctions are absence of trust, fear of conflict, lack of commitment, avoidance of accountability, inattention to results. And to go through those, you really have to build a foundation of trust. So we sat around, gave our family history, our personal history, why we do what we do, why do we act the way we act. We went around the table and gave feedback on our strengths and weaknesses, received feedback on our own strengths and weaknesses. We dug into our individual personality profiles, looked at how those individual profiles make a team personality. These can be really difficult conversations, but they're necessary to establish the trust and communication that a team needs to see. Throughout the book, there's an analogy of sports all the time brought up. And one of the things is, you know, every NBA team has good players, but what makes the difference between a championship team and one that gets last place? They're all good, but it's ones that learn how to play as a team. For me, having the military experience, I know you have to take these issues head on and work through uncomfortableness to build effective strategy and culture.
What a great answer. I'm hearing lots of teamwork and cohesion of the team. I love that. Don, what advice would you give someone making like a radical career change?
Yeah, and I would say from the military to the civilian sector is pretty radical, but even those who have been in the same career for quite a while would probably be a radical change. In the military, we kind of talk about being institutionalized. Many times you live on base, you have the food prepared for you, you have your own medical. So when individuals transition from the military over to the civilian sector, many things that we take for granted, whether it's health insurance or even commuting, you know, is kind of new. So as you really kind of think about that, I would say research, kind of know what you want to do, find the commonalities between what you've done in the military and what career you may want to move into, and find a friend or a mentor to kind of help you with that. And lastly, be patient. It takes time. Your first job out of the military probably won't be the last job that you have in your life. So really kind of take it as a journey and learn from everything as you go along.
That's so great. And actually, Eric, before we get to you, I'd like to ask the group, do any of you have any advice that's different than Don's, or that maybe has to do with making this career change?
No, Don, now.
Thanks, Bert.
You know, I could probably piggyback off of Don a little bit and what he said about being open. You know, don't be afraid. I guess as far as advice, don't be afraid to try different career paths and move from one career to the next and be open. You know, the transition from military life to civilian life it's really a journey that lasts. It can last for decades, in my opinion. And also for me personally as well. And you may have different interests that you could only have in certain careers, and don't be afraid to try them. And because your resume and all of your experiences can build on one another, even if you're going from something completely, one career that's completely opposite to another. And so that's, as a veteran, you want to, or really anyone in general, don't be afraid to be open and try new things.
Yeah, what a great reminder. I'm sorry, Becky, go ahead.
Oh, I to piggyback off of what Eric was saying, yes, don't be afraid to try different things. And some skills are easier to translate into the civilian side than others. And it may take a few internships or a few different degree paths to find where you're most comfortable and where your family is most comfortable.
Absolutely. Eric, let's go back to you. How has your military experience enhanced your ability to succeed educationally and professionally?
That's a really good question. You know, coming out of the military, I was 22. So I joined the military when I was 18 years old, right out of high school. Came out when I was, got out when I was 22, January of 2011. That same month, I went straight to work. I went straight to school and on my education, started using the GI Bill. And I think that what I learned from the military and having the work ethic, the structure, I just applied that directly to my education. And also when you go into the military at the age of 18 and you go overseas and you see some terrible things and have these experiences, you grow up very fast. I was a very mature 22-year-old and mature freshman in college. And so that also helped my success in college. And then one of the things I really latched on to is not being afraid. I think I hit on it earlier is, you know, I was in the infantry, and that is the grunt work of the grunt work. And when you're getting into the professional business or professional arena, you have to be willing to do the grunt work. So what did I do when I got into finance and got my first internship? I was making copies, filing papers, 22-year-old, you know, veteran, got back from my two tours of Afghanistan, and I'm in an office filing paperwork and making copies for an advisory team. But you know, being willing to do that grunt work is really, really important to get your start.
Eric, I think we've all been there.
Yeah, I think we all have.
Brick, a question for you. What is the one thing you would do differently if you could replan your military career to optimize your transition into the civilian life?
I think Don and I are probably fairly similar, that the you know, going through the Soviet Cold War, and then into Gulf War, and then into the terrorism realm as an aviator, the priority for naval aviators, in particular strike fighter pilots, was to stay in the cockpit and deploy. A lot of the other services and a lot of the colleagues probably on here had opportunities for outside the main discipline career progression opportunities, including education, fellowships, and those type of things. And had I do it over, then I would probably have pursued those and probably would have sacrificed some of my cockpit time and my deployment time to be a little bit more competitive, savvy, and have relationships outside of the military when it came time for transition.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, sometimes you don't know what you don't know. So that's so helpful. Becky, I'm going to go back to you. What would you tell your middle school self, or maybe another girl that's about that age, about military service?
I would do it all over again. I loved it. It's the greatest honor of my life. And I would tell any young woman that's interested in the military to do things that would prepare you for that lifestyle. Go away to camp, do team sports, get involved in school leadership activities, do scouting. Those sorts of things will hone your ability to be part of a team and work for a team. I never want to encourage anyone to join the military just to get benefits. I want them to join out of a genuine sense of service and wanting to be part of this team. So my advice would be find someone who can guide you into it and get involved in the right activities throughout your high school career that would tee up to a military service.
Oh, I think that's perfect. Thank you so much for sharing. Daniel, now you taught managerial skills at CLU. Have you read any good books lately that apply to business?
Yeah, no, I've read two books lately that I published several years back, but I found them extremely relevant and impactful to just daily business operations. Power of Habit by Charles Duhigg and The Black Swan by Nassim Taleb. The Power of Habit starts out with the story of, about the brain and the part of the brain called like the basal ganglia, and how if you repeat something consistently, it just becomes a part of the basal ganglia. So something you do without thinking, a habit. You know, I'm a surfer and surfing's really difficult to learn, but once you do, it is like riding a bike. Once you repeat that so many times, you may be rusty, but you never forget. But what I found most interesting about the book is once you establish a pattern like that, the question really becomes how do you change it if you want to change it? And it turns out through studies that like the number one indicator of success of changing habits is simple observation. So journaling, observing the moment. And I thought that was really cool because how do you change things? And it can be really difficult, but if you just say, hey, let me just kind of just observe the feelings around this habit, that's what indicates you changing it the most. And then The Black Swan, when you first read Nassim Taleb, and he has several books, The Black Swan was the first I read of him. He comes off as like abrasive and arrogant, and then you realize he's just super smart. But Nassim grew up in Lebanon when the Civil War started there. And so he just stayed in the basement reading books, and that led him eventually to Wharton, where he got his MBA, and then Wall Street, where he made millions trading. And he also developed kind of a disdain for long-term projections because in his belief, and I would say verifiably so, black swans are the events of magnitude that really drive economic cycles. So his big thing, Nassim's big thing is, our biases are what keeps us from seeing these events. We get to see one speck of the amount of data that's occurring in the world. And he says, you know, it's not about the books you have read, it's about the books you haven't read. So the main point is we are not very good at seeing things for what they are and predicting the future. So we should constantly check our biases because we all have them. And you might not even have a clue what they are. So constantly challenging yourself, and both of those things combined, you know, observing your thoughts and challenging your thoughts, I thought were really impactful. And that's something I brought daily to, you know, our business and our strategy that we try and implement.
That's so great. So panel, show of hands, who loves to journal? I'm the only one. All right. It's just the two of us, Daniel. I think it's incredibly important. I agree with you.
I journal up here.
Well, Don, I'm going to go to you next. What has been your biggest challenge as a dual career professional?
Yeah, I think Becky kind of hit on it. It's time management, regardless of where you are, you know, trying to manage family and work and everything. You know, you kind of throw two jobs on top of it, and it just kind of exponentially increases. So actually, I wouldn't say the best time, but the easiest times I had was when I was deployed, because I only had one job to focus on. Maybe it wasn't so easy on the family back home, but from that standpoint, it was. But I would say it's kind of focusing both on the micro aspects of the job and the macro. So kind of taking a look at what's right in front of you, the tasks that you need to do, but don't forget to look forward. Don't forget to kind of plan your own strategy. Where do you want to be, you know, months and years from now, while you're still working on the immediate tasks that have to get done and accomplished?
That's so important to remember. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Eric, I'm going to ask you this question, but I would love to hear from anyone else if they might have something. So Eric, you first. Do you have any advice for military veterans in the midst of finding their civilian life path?
That's actually a great, great question. And I know we all kind of had some points throughout this time. And I really want to kind of take this opportunity to kind of be real with the audience. And I think really for veterans transitioning, it's extremely important to make sure that you are focusing on yourself and your well-being. Transitioning from the military, whether you have PTSD or other struggles, you want to make sure that you are seeking help, and don't be afraid to rely on others for that help and to really get started. I know too many veterans who are struggling and have struggled and have also done the unthinkable because of their PTSD and emotional issues. So to take it away from the professional side, you know, the personal side should come first for transitioning vets, and then we could really focus on the professional side. So I guess that advice is really just don't be afraid to seek help.
Yeah, that's great advice. Does anyone else have anything to add on that? So impactful, Eric. Thank you.
If I may, Patty, you know, I do work with a lot of veterans organizations. Obviously, there are veterans that come out of the service hurt in a variety of different ways that need help and support in order to transition into a different life in a different world. But there are a lot of them that come out eager to start a new career, and it's very beneficial to have somebody that's gone through that process and can, number one, do a fit check on what they really want to do, where they want to live, how they want to live, and then help them map a path and then start connecting them with people that can assist them along that journey. And it's folks, you know, like me and Don and others that have been in the service for a really long time and been in the civilian world for a long time that can really help and assist in making that transition and that fit check for what they want to be when they grow up. I think I'm still trying to figure that out, but a lot easier.
Yeah, and I would just add on that it's very similar, but the networking. I think the networking is so important. Finding a mentor outside, you know, a military mentor that's maybe made the transition, maybe someone that hasn't been in the military that's in the business world or whatever industry you're trying to get into, but find a network. There's so many events, out there to be involved in. And I think the power of your network is so important.
Anyone else before we move on?
I would say that those are all great comments. And many times we get very fixated on labels, you know, SEAL, Top Gun, you know, Marine, that sort of thing. But that's an occupation. That's not who or what you are. So we need to be proud of those things, but then also recognize to move on when we make those transitions. And I think sometimes, you know, people just kind of carry that with them throughout their lives and don't really kind of give the future a chance because they're too focused on the past.
Thank you, Don. Something's very important to remember. Brick, I'm going to switch gears here for just a minute and give you the next question. How do transitioned senior veterans view the popular DEI movement?
I will say that we have a non-negotiable leadership code that places non-negotiable value on treating everybody fairly, morally, and with respect. We have a leadership code that tells us that we invest passionately in our talent and our people and take care of our talent and our people. And our leadership code that also tells us that we have to embrace diversity because that's where value can be found. I think DEI exists because there's a paucity of leadership in the world, and including the military in some areas. And if you follow those leadership code non-negotiables, you won't really have those kind of issues. If you look at the forces that we all have served in, it's a widely diverse group of people from all over the country, all ethnicities, all religions, and we find a way to be family. To be a team and do some unbelievable, extraordinarily challenging things and do it almost every time without incident. And so that's kind of where I go all the time is with good leadership development and good culture, like Daniel was talking about. The DEI is a byproduct of all those things.
Non-negotiable for the military and non-negotiable for your work life. Brick, thank you so much. And it's time for a break. Thank you everyone for being here. Stay tuned for some more.
In 2020, just as we were experiencing a new feeling of creativity and fun, New West Symphony and the rest of the world was unexpectedly silenced. Uncertainty drove us all to stretch beyond our comfort zones, and we each experienced a deep need to connect. And so, we welcomed new practices. Young and old toiled with emerging technology, and we turned to our enterprising musicians to chart a new course. Because of you, we were able to gather safely in an empty hall with bright lights and cameras to make music together. And we saw that we were certainly not alone, because culture and tradition transcend adversity. And you reached out to support us. You made it possible for us to lift up our musicians. You helped us realize why we create. You were there in those moments when our work helped us to connect and draw each other near. Thank you for being on this journey with us. The new normal isn't as much of a challenge as it is an opportunity to enrich, entertain, and educate our growing community. With your help, we can make this the best possible place to live.
I looked around at my other colleagues and I realized everybody had an MBA, and that's when I knew if I wanted to go any further in this company, I needed to further my education.
The executive MBA at Cal Lutheran is really a chance to further your education, but in an atmosphere that's conducive to your world.
PR, marketing, statistics, metrics, analytics, all those things that I learned in the program, I'm able to apply.
It was just great to have faculty who have the real world experience, but also understand how to impart that knowledge to folks in a classroom. it's an accomplishment that you can share with your existing network to help you kind of advance to the next level.
It actually got me into an interview for a different position.
I got promoted to the director of programming and operations for the whole music department.
You're going to walk back into your job or into a new job and really kind of have a wider view of what the possibilities are. To me, that's the number one thing.
And we're back. Okay, in this final segment with more Q&A and interviews with Jennifer Caldwell, Dr. Danny Fire, Dan Mizell, and Natalia Steniva, the CEO of the New West Symphony and the New West Summerfest. And of course, questions from the chat. First, let's hear from Dr. Danny Fire, emergency room doctor at the Ventura County Medical Center. Dr. Danny, tell us what we need to be doing to be safe for the rest of this summer.
Hi, I'm Danny Fear, emergency physician in Ventura and co-founder of Cross Country Medics, a disaster relief company focusing on both federal and private EMS services. Today, I'm going to share with you quick 10 commandments for summer health. Number one, stay hydrated. Beat the heat, stay in the shade, stay cool, use well-ventilated clothing, make sure you use mineral sunscreen if available, and brim hats. Let's bring back the style. Number two, alcohol is not the beverage of choice for hydration. Water and electrolytes are preferred. Number three, snake envenomation. You get bit. Make sure you immobilize the area that you bit. Do not place a tourniquet. Note time of when you get bit. Make sure you keep it elevated. Monitor for any signs of an allergic reaction and go to the emergency department. Do not identify or bring the snake to me. Number four is the topic of allergic reaction. If you've had a severe allergic reaction in the past, carry an up-to-date EpiPen. Make sure you can also take over-the-counter antihistamines if approved by your doctor, and make sure it's not life-threatening to ensure a ride to the emergency department. Number five is if you think you're having a heart attack, take a baby aspirin and come to the emergency department to get evaluated. Number six, good old food poisoning. So usually mayo and dairy are the culprit. Keep it cool, keep it in the shade. And if you experience any symptoms of food poisoning or think it's food poisoning, bland diet, hydrate, and if your symptoms do not resolve, go to the emergency department. Number seven is you're out hiking, you break an ankle, so immobilize the joint, monitor for any signs or symptoms, and have a friend bring you to the trailhead and have EMS or a private vehicle take you to the emergency department. NSAIDs can be helpful if approved by your doctor. And number eight is you're traveling in the mountains. Altitude sickness is real. Acclimatize slowly. Hydrate for prevention. Short hikes in the first few days. Take it easy. Monitor for any signs of altitude sickness, such as headache, nausea, vomiting, any weakness, shortness of breath. Descend if you experience those. Hydrate and go to the emergency department if those symptoms do not resolve. Number nine, nosebleeds. Keep the nose moist with saline flushes if needed, over-the-counter Afrin if you do experience nosebleeds, if approved by your doctor, and local pressure, pressure over the bridge of the nose for 10 to 15 minutes, usually abates the bleed. Number 10, swim safety, swim with a buddy. Buddy checks are key, do not dive in shallow water. Cervical spine injuries are life-threatening and debilitating and can be easily avoided. So signing out, make sure you find a local CPR course to note what an emergency is, how to prevent it, what to do, and stay safe, enjoy, and hopefully I don't see you in the emergency department.
Thanks, Dr. Danny. I'm staying hydrated. Now let's hear from Dan Mizell, Executive Director of the Anti-Defamation League of the Tri-Counties. Dan?
Hi. It's a pleasure to join you all today. My name is Dan Mizell, and I'm the Regional Director for the Anti-Defamation League's office that serves Ventura, Santa Barbara, and San Luis Obispo counties. ADL was founded in 1913 with a mission to stop the defamation of the Jewish people and to secure justice and fair treatment to all. The founders understood then that no minority or marginalized group is safe unless all such groups are safe, and ADL has developed over time into a leading organization countering anti-Semitism and all forms of bigotry. Most of the time, we're doing so through a combination of investigation and education. An example of our work includes monitoring the in-person and online activities of groups like the one that created the anti-Semitic flyers that were recently distributed in Moore Park and Thousand Oaks neighborhoods, and then reporting the identities of those creators and their online activity to law enforcement. We do the same with white supremacist groups. We also provide educational programming for teachers and students about creating inclusive classrooms and responding to incidents of bias or bullying. We've worked with many Ventura County schools in the past and look forward to continuing that work this fall with schools in Moore Park, Thousand Oaks, Pleasant Valley, Ventura Unified, and elsewhere. We also provide similar programming for community groups and workplaces that tend to get very positive reviews from participants across the political spectrum. In light of the multiple troubling incidents in recent months, the banner hangs, the anti-Semitic flyers, the vandalism at Maple Elementary School, I'm pleased to announce that we'll be hosting a community walk against hate in Thousand Oaks in early March of 2023. ADL's hosted similar events around the country with great outcomes. They tend to be a great opportunity for a community to come together and educate each other about the varied backgrounds that make this community all that it is. We'll soon be identifying sponsors for this event and planning an informational meeting in early October. If you'd like to contact us now with interest about sponsoring that event or about our educational programming, you can reach me at dmeisel, it's D-M-E-I-S-E-L, at adl.org, or by phone at 805-680-5973. Thank you for having me, and I look forward to meeting you all in person.
Dan, thanks so much. I've got my walking shoes ready. Jennifer Caldwell, tell us what you and Monica White are up to at Food Share.
Aw, thank you, Patty. So good to see you. I'm so glad to be here today with you, what an amazing group of panelists that you have. I'm so excited to share about Fed Up. It's Food Share's new signature event, inaugural event that we have this year coming up on Friday, September 23rd, here at Food Share. And I think why I'm so excited about this is some of you may remember in the past, we've done what's called the Blue Jean Ball, which was so much fun. It was absolutely an amazing event to plan and a fun event to come to and be at. But when you left, you had fun, but we really didn't leave you filling with purpose, right? Our mission driven and who Food Share is. And so we really wanted to change that. In the last 2 years, obviously our focus has been disaster relief, and we're still doing that. We're still feeding Ventura County at a historical rate. But what we wanted to do is we really wanted to bring back something fun, but mission driven. So we're doing what's called Fed Up here at Food Share Friday, September 23rd. You'll get an exclusive tour of our warehouse. We're doing and showing you things that we normally don't with just any old tour. So I highly recommend you visit us here. We're going to feed you. We're going to just fill you with purpose and mission and just love. And what we were really aiming to do is not only at that event, make sure that you're fed up, but we really want to make sure that Ventura County and those that are food insecure are fed up as well. And we need the help to do it. So I encourage you, foodshare.com/fedup to purchase your tickets. We only have a little bit left. Friday, September 23rd, join us and get fed up.
Jennifer, that's so great. I'm writing it all down now. And finally, Natalia Staniva, excuse me, from the New West Symphony and the upcoming New West Summerfest. I'm so excited. Tell me all about it.
Thank you, Patty. I wanted to say it is such an honor to be closing 5 at 5 today. One of my interns is considering a career in military, and I think she will benefit from this program. And thank you all for your service. And thank you for asking about Summerfest. After reaching nearly a million concert goers, the New West Symphony has come back live after the pandemic with new initiatives, live and recorded concerts with our Grammy Award-winning music director, Michael Christie. We're moving forward to creating a one-of-a-kind destination for the performing arts in Ventura County. Think Hollywood Bowl meets Summer Festival in a gorgeous location. Our lineup includes popular bands, established bands, soloists performing with a full symphony orchestra. Summerfest is coming up next June. With this new addition to the season, we will offer our community a year-round programming. So we start the concerts at the Civic Arts Plaza in Thousand Oaks and Camarillo in October, November. And I wanted to share that one of my favorite concerts this season is going to be our Winterfest in December. And it's going to be an extravaganza of holiday favorites with vocal and recording sensation Sam Harris. He is a star of Broadway, film, television. It will also feature Ukrainian folk ensemble, mariachi band, children's choir, you name it. It's all going to be under the umbrella of the New West Symphony with the New West Symphony professional musicians on stage. So both our summer and winter fest will be the highlights of cultural life here in Ventura County. And we hope that going to the symphony in summer or winter or year round will become the tradition you'd share with your friends and loved ones. So more information about the symphony and our elegant, stunning, entertaining and inspiring events at newwestsymphony.org. So thank you so much, Pattie.
Thank you. And thanks for all that great information. I really look forward to it. Back to our panel. Before we get some final thoughts from you, we did have a question from Twitter. And all of you are welcome to answer this. The question is, what's the best way to approach the academy or other ways to get into the military service?
Well, I'll give it a shot first. I think all of us would say, join the Navy. since we're all from there. Throwing you in that, Eric. I know you're a Marine, but... But I think we all come from different backgrounds. I was ROTC. I think we have some academy. We have enlisted. It's really think about what you want to get out of the military. I know Becky said, you know, you don't do it for the benefits. You do it for the job opportunities and the career that you want. When I've spoken to people about it, I've really asked them, what do you want to do? The military pretty much has a career type for anything that you want to do. Whether you want to be in one of the kind of the combat arms, whether myself like SEAL, SWO, pilot, whether you want to be support, intel, cyber, programmer, medicine, it's really any career field is just about open to you. So think about it, and then kind of once you decide on that, decide which service is best.
If I'm Patty, I served on a congressman's selection panel for the service academies. So I reviewed about 60 packets a year when I was doing that for all the service academies. There is some very specific processes. The first two steps would be to go to the academy that you would like to go to, get signed up for their admissions communications, and then simultaneously go to your local congressman's website. They will have a service academy page where you can submit your information, download a packet and a checklist, and that'll get you started. Once you start that process, all the service academies have what the Navy calls blue and gold officers, but they're advocates and mentors that will shepherd you through the process of going through the application. That's the best way to do it. By all means, if you have anybody, friends, family that have been in any one of the service academies, reach out to them and get their advice, counsel, and have them share their experiences with you.
Yeah, as Daniel said earlier, it's all about your network. Thank you so much, Rick, for sharing that. We actually have one more question. I believe it was through Facebook. Are CalU and other local universities ready to handle veterans as they return home?
I could actually answer that, Patty. So I ended up going to Cal Lutheran for undergrad, and as a veteran, and I have to say, Cal Lutheran has a robust program for veterans returning home, and they actually have a veteran resource group and a veteran resource center. They actually offer free counseling services. They have a faculty, staff, and administrator network specifically for veterans. They have career services for veterans. One of those services is a writing center to help veterans write resumes and write cover letters. And part of their financial aid is they're also, even though they're a private university, they're part of the Yellow Ribbon Program, which is actually helps veterans who have the GI Bill. It helps cover that gap that the GI Bill does not cover when it comes to private universities. And I know that Pepperdine, I actually went there for graduate school. They have the exact same resources as far as the Yellow Ribbon Program and other things. So there are some very good universities locally that are really well set up for veterans. And coming from a student's perspective, I have to say that it was a very positive experience.
Thank you, Eric, so much for sharing that. It's so nice to know that our local community is so supportive of our veterans as they're returning home. So thank you for that. And really, thank you, everyone. That's a wrap. Be sure to tune in again every month on the third Tuesday of the month for more Live at 5. We'll see you next time.